Thank you for joining the American Cinematheque Symposium for Women Make Film, presented in partnership with Turner Classic Movie on the occasion of TCM Present Women Make Film. I'm Gwen DeGlees, head programmer for the American Cinematheque, and I'd like to invite you to visit our website, americancinematheque.com, for information about our upcoming event, as well as how you can support the American Cinematheque by becoming a member and making a donation. This symposium is with director Cheryl Donnier, Deborah Granick, Amy Semetz, and Lulu Wang, film professor Jacqueline Stewart, co-host of TCM Women Make Film and Silent Sunday's Night, lead the conversation. Enjoy.
Hi, everyone. Hi, distinguished panelists. So great to be with you. As Gwen said, I'm Jacqueline Stewart from TCM. And I'll be moderating tonight's symposium with these four incredibly accomplished visionary filmmakers. Before we get started, I think it's only appropriate as we kick off this conversation about women visionaries that we pay tribute to Ruth Bader Ginsburg, who passed away last night. Such a powerful, brilliant thinker and advocate for women. And I think that it would be just most fitting for us to recall her incredible model as we think about the status of women in media and the importance of women's voices. So Cheryl, Amy, Lulu, Deborah, it's such an honor to be with the four of you tonight.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you for having us.
Yes, really. Thank you for everyone.
So let's get this started. As Gwen mentioned, this is a symposium that is being presented in conjunction with the Women Make Film series that's being presented on TCM on Tuesday nights. It's running through December 1st. And that series is inspired by Mark Cousins' documentary, Women Make Film, which is just an epic look at the filmmaking of women all around the world since the beginnings of cinema. And he describes his project as a kind of masterclass in filmmaking, using hundreds and hundreds of examples of clips from films made by women. And I thought we might kick off our conversation tonight by going around and talking about the different paths that you four have taken into filmmaking, and especially what your inspirations were, like what the spark was that got you to imagine yourself pursuing a career as a filmmaker. Deborah, maybe you could start.
Yeah, it's been rattling around my head a lot. Because the times kind of just repeat themselves. And I just recently watched the documentary Feminists, What Were They Thinking? And brought back a lot of my coming of age. And I was realizing that a lot of my route of entry was the first wave of Time's Up on so many issues where there was a male domination of a whole range of life. And women made documentaries were starting to peel that back. And so I was studying politics, and it was inextricably linked. Like the truth telling was in these documentaries. And I was noticing that they were women made, many, many. And so Julia Reichardt, Koppel, you know, the list started to accumulate in my viewing and in my daily life and in, of course, cross-pollinating what I was learning. So yes, my route of entry was definitely documentary, and not just knowing that women made them. Like, it wasn't like, oh, when can women make them? Can more women make them? It was just women were already making them. And so that's why I felt like that mission or that pursuit was something that women do, you know, as a college student. That's how I was viewing it. So
yeah, and seeing those examples really made a difference for you. Yeah. Cheryl, what about you? Were there models of filmmakers that were particularly inspiring to you?
Well, thank you for the question. I think for me, it's very specific. It was the late 80s. I was sort of involved in ACT UP. I was going to Temple University, just wandering through their radio, television, and film program. But I was taking all these other courses, like, you know, women's studies, African-American studies, just kind of piecing it together so I could think about subject, right? It was that year, I think, that Spike Lee did She's Gotta Have It. And I went to the screening, you know, and saw the film, and every sister in Philly was upset. So he had this little lecture at University of Penn, and he was, you know, getting, you know, anybody wants a question, and there's a line of African-American women, like, ready to go him at about Nola, and, like, what he was trying to do, and, you know, why did he present her that way, and he's like, look, if you want to make a movie and have that, those characters kind of well-rounded and whatever, make it yourself, you know, this is my film, this is my story, and everybody was like, but light bulb went on for me, and it was like, I'll make some movies, you know? So it was a perfect time to really put all my ideas together. And then I ran into, at like a women's fest, Sapphire, the poet who was reading this poem called Wild Thing. And that was gonna be my thesis piece. So I had like tons of video equipment, big cameras. Went and filmed her reading the poem, and she was lovely, wonderful. It was about the Central Park Five. And it was just really moving. And I realized that I could latch onto this and put my own images and put, you know, my own take, my own politic, who I was as a young, you know, Black lesbian in Philly onto that landscape and make a sort of montage. And that was it. That was the first piece. And I just kept going.
So that challenge from Spike Lee, right? Like, tell the world story. You took that literally.
Right. Thank you, Spike.
Lulu, could you talk a bit about what some of the films were that sort of sparked the sense that you had that you wanted to be a filmmaker yourself?
Yeah. When I moved to the States with my parents, I was 6. We came as immigrants. And so I didn't really have access to art films, and I never saw cinema as cinema. It was, to me, it was just movies or television. It was just American media. And it was how I learned about America and culture. And so it wasn't until I went to college in Boston and I took a film 101 class, and we watched a lot of American filmmakers, but they were predominantly, I would say, yeah, it was actually like 99.9% male. And, you know, all the classics. But then I went and I took a world cinema class, and I actually discovered Asian filmmakers through a film class, like not through my family or their background, but through this world cinema class. And then I also took, at the same time, a feminist film theory class. And so having all of these perspectives, and through feminist film theory, we talked a lot about the shifting to the female gaze. And we watched films like The Piano and The Pianist and, Piano Teacher and Secretary. And so we were reading a lot of theory about it as well. And so I think that just started getting me thinking about what the female gaze is and shifting away from like all of this stuff that I had seen my whole life that was through the male gaze, being to be the subject as opposed to the object, and also the exploration of female desire. And I think, you know, at that time it was just really exciting to explore my own sexuality through the female gaze, which I just had never thought about. And, you know, I come from sort of a more conservative background. I would say that was the beginning of it. But I don't think, to be honest, I really found my voice or really had the confidence to believe that I could go and, like, I didn't quite, you know, I didn't see anything that was so specifically me, like Asian American. I, you know, saw like films from Asia. I saw, you know, women filmmakers who were European, but I, you know, never specifically saw my own experience represented. And it, you know, even though I started pursuing filmmaking, it took me years and years before I realized like, oh, I actually have to create from exactly where I am.
Mm. Mm. Yeah, I mean, I think that really resonates with what Cheryl was saying, right? Like you can watch a lot of stuff. It can be inspirational in some ways, but it doesn't necessarily mean, what it might show is that there's a gap that you feel that you need to, you might play a role in filling. Yeah. And as a professor, I love how all three of you have talked about how watching a lot of films in a college environment, kind of like actually got these ideas percolating for you. So Amy, what about you? Can you just talk us through a little bit some of the films that you saw early on that may have produced some of the spark in you to enter a career in filmmaking?
I didn't come from artists at all and came from very meager background but I was excelling in math and science, and so to much of my parents' disappointment, I decided I wanted to make films and not pursue being a doctor, because I was going to be the first doctor in my family. But because I didn't come from an arts background, I think the first film I saw was Welcome to the Dollhouse, which was Todd Sloan's. And I was just like, this is strange. And this feels more akin to my family and those weirdo experiences that I'm experiencing than any Hollywood film that I had seen. And then really didn't know anything about, like Lulu was saying, about cinema. Wasn't exposed to like art, wasn't exposed, and was sort of behind when I did a semester at NYU and felt really out of place, but was exposed to like Godard and all these things that everyone had been exposed to. And then found my way like towards female filmmakers later on. But I wasn't, we'll put it this way. Like my parents were, I have to thank my parents because they were like, you can do anything. They never said anything about challenges about being a woman or anything. They were very encouraging until I said I wanted to do film. And then they were not so thrilled, but, and so I had been making films and I went to school, but I was in the literature program at Florida State. And I knew Barry Jenkins and Adela Rumansky and all these people that were going there at the film school, but I was in literature at the time. And I knew I wanted to make films, but I didn't necessarily know how, and didn't necessarily know specifically what voice meant, if that makes sense, until probably my mid-20s or 24. I was still making films, but then I saw Barbara Loden's Wanda at a screening of her print, and I was like, that to me is voice. Like it suddenly clicked with me, where it's like I hadn't seen that before. I hadn't seen, you know, a movie from the 60s or the 70s where a woman was just allowed to be irredeemable in a way. And we've seen all these irredeemable men that we like fall in love with as these characters in cinema. And that was sort of, to me, like a big turning point in freedom for me to explore characters in a way.
Yeah, and Wanda is one of the films that we're featuring as a part of our series. Such an important film for all the reasons you just described. And it would be great to hear you all talk more about this question of having the exposure to films by women. I mean, this is one of the things that we're hearing over and over again in response to this series, in response to the documentary, that people are amazed that there are so many women filmmakers they've never heard of. That this is a project that really is kind of restoring a sense of, presence, balance maybe toward equity in representing the activities of women filmmakers. So maybe I can come back to you, Lulu. When one of the questions here, I think, has to do with distribution, right? With the circulation of films by women. And could you talk a little bit about some of the things that you have noticed in your own career or in looking at the work of other women filmmakers in terms of how far they circulate, how they do or do not reach their audiences?
Yeah, I think that, going back to when I didn't go to film school, but I went in that college course, I think there is this assumption, you know, of who is the audience. There's an assumption of who films are being made for, and so, and who's relating to it. And so, yeah, I didn't see a lot of films made by women. And I think there's also a sort of set idea of what a great film looks like. And if you define greatness, if the person defining, if the group of people defining greatness has traditionally been one type of person, then that's what the great films are going to look like, because it's going to, you know, have to match what they, the criteria that they set, you know, they created the rule book. And so I think that's something that I've been thinking more and more about, you know, like what is considered epic, and through the, you know, through the male lens versus the female lens. And so then what is a film that is considered relatable and universal, because universal to who, you know? And so, yeah, and I think that's really problematic, because all of these assumptions, you know, for the longest time, and I'm sure there's it's still there, I had so many blind spots where I just assumed I didn't fit in, or, you know, I never thought, oh, there's something wrong with the system that I'm not seeing this. I just felt, you know, like I was on the outside, and that's what it was. And the only way that I could make films is if I made films through that lens and from that perspective. I don't know why it didn't click for so long that actually I can shift and go the other way and do something completely different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Cheryl, I wonder if you have any thoughts about this, about feeling as though you were not exposed to the range of work that more and more now we're becoming aware of by women.
I mean, I think as a African-American queer woman, you know, in this world now and then, I didn't see myself anywhere, right? I didn't see myself on television. I was not a member of the Cosby Show. There was nobody like me anywhere. And in the 80s, I was also being very political. So at one point I was like a constant volunteer at the anarchist bookstore in Philly, the Wooden Shoe. So I knew how to locate myself on the margins, right? And that's sort of around the time that I was making a lot of work at Temple University as an undergrad. And I was lucky to have a professor named Michelle Parkerson. And she, in her class, beyond turning me on to documentaries about African-American lesbians, you know, was making work herself. So I got to see Stormy Lady of the Jewel Box that she did, just a whole slew of wonderful images. Nothing narrative was I seeing, but definitely, you know, seeing documentaries. Knowing where she rented them from was something that was important. So Women Make Movies, Debbie Zimmerman. Maybe they were the fiscal sponsors for the Watermelon Woman. I mean, I just knew how to kind of go on that path. You know, at the Wooden Shoe, there might have been stuff. So I just did my research. I dig deep to find something. You know, I love the archive. I go in there. I love the libraries to go find stuff. So I was, you know, really just like a nerd, if they call those things then, but I was really looking up like what's behind, like where did they get this from? Who did, you know, so I was able to kind of find something in looking for myself. But, you know, when it came down to sort of narrative storytelling about African-American lesbians, there was none. So that really located me in the position to, you know, find the power and the wisdom to do it myself. But I was fortunate enough to see, again, Michelle Parkerson turned me on to a lot of things. I had another professor. So I think the Academy, and depending on when you were in the Academy and how you sort of navigated through the Academy, really led you through this path, because I didn't go to film school either, but it led you through this path to figure it out and how you could piece that together, you know? So, or how you kind of, and who you were as a person could have led you around. So not seeing myself and looking for myself, that search for myself led me to a lot of, you know, work by men, but also the few, you know, crumbles of work by women, in particular, like looking for like lesbian work, you know, Claire of the Moon, you know, things like that. I mean, there was stuff out there, you had to find it. So I did a lot of digging and finding. And it inspired me to, again, fill that void. But, you know, Chantal Ackerman, there's stuff out there, you know. So I thank those foremothers. And I was fortunate enough for those professors to bring in people too. So I think like Barbara Hammer came in, you know. It's just, you know, it depends on how you navigate through what you're learning and who's teaching you. If it's a male professor, you know, what do you get? If it's, you know, they're trying to be well-rounded. If it's a female professor, I was fortunate, again, having a maker who was making work and turning me on to everything.
Yeah. And you actually started to address one of our audience questions that I might sort of like pose to everyone. Someone is asking how important you all believe knowledge of film, this film theory and history have been to shaping your style as a director. I might combine that with another question that came in from the audience, which is the question, do you think that someone has to go to film school to be a good filmmaker or writer? I think some of you have already indicated no, because you're amazing filmmakers and writers, some of you who did not go to film school. But this question of education and what types of film education are actually useful, beneficial to you as creators. Deborah, do you have a thought about that?
Yeah, I don't know what it would have been like to be exposed to this series. I mean, I would have had a completely different understanding of how much work had been done and how diverse it was and what risk taking, how experimental it was at times in different countries. You know, it would have transformed my understanding that it wasn't this rare. It's like when the museums in the last 3 years, all of a sudden, every single decade in the museums of modern art around the world, they've been able to find work by women. in a museum I was in France last summer, every century, every decade of every century, each room, they made a mandate. They put work by women in every room from 1400 to now, you know? So this is what this series is like. It's like, is it the films had been in boxes, you know, and no one talked about them. So, you as someone who actually, you know, actively teaches, you know, you're probably really relating to what I'm saying, that the sheer quantity and the wideness of the spectrum of what's included in this collection, I don't think many women around the world knew.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you couldn't have known. Very few scholars could have known about all of it in every country at all times, you know, as this series has shown and what it unearthed, you know. So, yeah, my head was blown, basically, but it was very, very different than how I formed my opinions of what kind of work had been done previously, which I thought was scant and it was never around and it didn't exist and certainly in the earlier part of last century, wasn't aware of how much was being done.
Yeah. Well, you mentioned the mandate, right? Like with the intentionality, with the collaborative research, we can unearth some of these histories that have been suppressed.
Yes.
I want to go to another audience question that I love. It has to do with more generally what inspires you as artists. So the question is, what today inspires your work most? Is it music? Is it books? Is it dreams? Amy, could you maybe take this up? I was asking about what films inspired you, but is there a wider, you know, body of art, of personal experience that inspires you?
It's always been anger, and maybe it's because it's hard for me to express it in my daily life, you know, like, and it's, I've never been inspired by something that where I'm like, well, that makes me really happy, I'm gonna sit down and write about it, you know. It's a lot of like, no, kind of like, excuse me, fuck that, like, fuck the way that this is, and also this feeling I don't really like, and like, let me try to put it into, specifically in cinema, you know, something that can transcend words. But it's usually something that like angers me or an unrest in some way. Mm-hmm. And then it inspires me to write. But, and then of course, cause I come from Florida, I like, there's obviously unrest in Florida in this, like, and so I'm always attracted to crime, like oriented stories, just coming from Florida and stuff like that.
Interesting. And like, it must be a very generative period for you right now because they're so
always angry. That's correct.
Cheryl, what about you? Are there, you know, other artists that inspire you, your dreams? Where does the inspiration come for you?
I mean, it's sort of about the void, you know, what's not there that inspires me, the dreaming to fill that void, the dreaming about anything, you know, I'm a dreamer, really, and even in the sense of being dreamers in a political sense as well. So politics, definitely. Intersectionality, I look for stories or things that are bumping up against each other, things where the stakes are really, you know, difficult in the world. You know, like, no, they're not this and that, and, you know, and then somebody did that to them, you know, whatever. So I always am looking with that lens of, you know, no way, you know, and let me dig deeper. So that, and then it just plain old invisibility, things that aren't there. Nothing's out there about it. Like, I'm going to find out and put that out there. Storytelling, something where a story is, you know, on the page or in the words, or when they're the stakes of a story are clashing and hold my attention, because there are some stories that are just like, oh gosh, you know. But and the way you configure the sort of nodes of storytelling, you know, the, you know, it has to have a character, an arc, or this and that, and how you can break it up. So it's really about the assemblage of storytelling that excites me when it's fresh. Quote unquote, when it's not the same, and people who flip things, like, I don't expect it, because I, again, going to school, I'm going to go back to that a little bit, to that last question, really allowed me to, one, use the library, because it was physically going to the library, have access to more knowledge than I have on my shelves, and two, it allowed me to get access to equipment. And if I didn't have access to equipment throughout my whole career, I would never, and that's even why I became an academic, and because I had access to equipment, I could make my own work. So it was some way to kind of keep it going. I never really had the funds, but I had access to, you know, a library, equipment, and collaborators. So it's all those sort of elements that get me to, you know, open the door to doing another project if I have all those kind of things together.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful, beautiful. Deborah, what today inspires you, inspires your work the most?
Yeah, I think, like Cheryl, I think I'm a pretty political beast, you know, by nature. And I think survival is something that never stops barraging me with questions, right? How in this predicament, in this situation, how is this person going to survive? What is their strategy, their navigation? What are their resources? You know, when do they deploy them? It's the when, where, how, you know, it's a classic set of questions about looking at a life that is usually different than my own and wondering how that character or that person or that life model is navigating it. Mm-hmm. And so trying to chronicle that. So, you know, you put it back, really, it's a much broader tradition. And the series showcased this beautifully. It is social realism. It is neorealism. You know, it is the chronicling of the lives of ordinary people and their survival. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so that's, But that comes through many different sources. It might be something I read. It might be a novel. It might be an article. It might be nonfiction. It might be something I've actually seen as I, you know, crossed the metropolis, you know. So the sources are varied, but the the path I end up going down in my curiosity or my wonderment or my is often similar.
You. Yeah, that through line of survival is there. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Lulu, what about you? What today is inspiring for you? Creative.
Well, from a storytelling perspective, I'm always looking for two things. One is the bittersweet, the feeling. I feel like I've always felt that the feeling of bittersweet sort of just represents all life and all aspects of life. that sense that you both want to laugh and cry at the same time, the ridiculous with the sublime, and the close proximity of those two things, and how, I mean, the world we're in now, there's every second is something completely ridiculous with something completely sublime, if you look for it, you know? And so much of that is about perspective. And so that's the other thing I look for, is multiple perspectives, stories that have nuances and different perspectives, and oftentimes no real answer. You know, I think that in my life, I try to find answers and solutions to everything because I'm OCD and I'm organized. And in my art, it's the way that I can explore things that I know deep down there is no real concrete answer, even though I want there to be. I want it to be simple, but there isn't. And so I really try to just go down and allow myself that exploration. And that being said, I think, you know, right now, specifically what's bringing me inspiration can be anything. It's music, books, and it could be even gardening. I think, you know, like ideas come to me when there's space, when there's boredom. And unfortunately, right, that's kind of the issue with art, is that you have to have the ability to have a lot of freedom and a lot of space. And not everyone has that privilege. And so I try to find that wherever I can, just moments or, and there's like even TV shows, you know, like I've been in, like I've had a feature film that is inspired by watching Survivor, or, you know, I've had like really weird inspirations that you would never connect, and somebody watching that film might never think, oh, that was inspired by a horror film, because my film is not a horror film. But I just think that you can, and going back to the previous question about education, I don't think it's about film school, but I think that we have to be eternal students at all times. And because you don't know where the, in order to continue growing, you don't know where your inspiration is gonna come from. And we're always looking for references. And so your reference can come from a documentary series where you go, oh, I love the way they did this, even though your thing, you know, your film or your show is not documentary, but there's things that you can steal. And the further away actually it is from the thing that you're working on, the more exciting it is to me, because it's like, oh, people will never see that I stole this thing. But it's just really fun to, yeah, like to make a family movie, but steal from a horror film, you know, like that kind of reference is just, yeah, it's just interesting.
Yeah, yeah. Just being really open to whatever sort of comes and then let it get processed through your own.
And not being like forced into a box otherwise, because then you're like, okay, I'm making a family movie. This is what family movies look like. This is how they should, this is how they're shot. It's gotta be close. And it's like, no, how do I do this and express what I want to express on screen and do it in a different way?
Mm-hmm. No, it's great that you raised this issue, because I'd love to pivot now to talk more about your craft, right? That your styles and the ways that you tell stories. This is one of the things that is so moving about Mark Cousins' documentary, that he really walks us through the different aspects of crafting a narrative, of introducing character, you know, of staging, of editing, of narrating different types of stories and relationships. He actually uses a clip, Cheryl, from Watermelon Woman really early on in the documentary when he's talking about introducing character, mm-hmm. because you famously play the character of Cheryl and you mic yourself and sit in front of the camera, and that's how we get introduced to that character. So I'd love to hear you talk about your approaches to introducing character, like what some of the fundamental aspects of that important gesture in a work entails for you.
Right, well, I mean, so say you are, you know, turned on by a book or a moment or whatnot, and you find your characters in that moment, you know, for me, I'll just use the Watermelon Woman. All right, so for the Watermelon Woman, for me, was looking, I want to do something about a Black lesbian, obviously. And so I started to look for Black lesbians and in any way, shape, or form that are, you know, out there. So it took me a long time in the early 90s to find enough positive representation of Black lesbian life. So knowing that, I knew that, like, here's the character I wanted to kind of create, because there was nothing out there. And then I sort of specifically went into Hollywood, you know, where are the Black lesbian, 2 in 20, there has to be, you know, Black lesbian Hollywood. Nothing in Tom Scoon's Malala's My Meat and Bucks, but in later books, there's some stuff in there, but not at that moment when that version of Tom Scoon's right. Malala's My Meat and Bucks. There was nothing in that. And there was nothing in The Celluloid Closet, really, that was there to talk about Black lesbians, and here's gay Hollywood. So right there and then, there was a way, like, I know what kind of character I have to create, right? I have to kind of create a character that doesn't exist, you know? And where do I begin with that is, you know, begin for my search for that character. So that was one thing about the documentary part about the Watermelon Woman and wanting to do that. But then, like, I wanted to see normal life, but with difficult stakes. So seeing Cheryl and Tamara having conflict at the beginning of the Watermelon Woman, or seeing in a stranger inside having a treasure in, you know, getting transferred, like before moments or after moments or in the middle of, but with really high stakes are when I like to kind of to start there. So you can, you know where you're at, think about what to expect and keep you interested or, you know, on line with it. And then there's a certain point where as filmmakers, or for me, you go past the audience and kind of get them running up to you. And then there's a point where you're running together. And then, you know, there's a point where you take them down to the end. So, you know, finding that right, either, you know, if it's a real character that inspired something, finding that right kind of before moment or after moment, but with, you know, what's not there, what's a sacrifice, how to make it, you know, really dramatic or really funny, you know. And then looking at genre and how to kind of twist that up too. So it's a lot of things, it really varies, but before moments of true characters' lives, like what was it like before this? Or what was it like after? You know, that's what I'm thinking about. What do queer and brown and lesbian, gay, LGBTQ people look like in the future where we're not really seeing a lot of them in the sense of surviving and having the main narrative, and they're starting, you know, Octavia Butler, I mean, they're there. So, it, you know, that's just, again, filling the searches for something that looks like me, smells like me, that I believe in, that engages me is what I look for, and then trying to figure out how to, you know, raise the stakes or you know, go before or after.
Actually, yeah, like how they exist sort of beyond the scope of the particular mm-hmm. work, and that's what makes a character really stay with you, right? When they expand beyond the boundaries of
a text of the world of anything, yeah.
Deborah, I'd love to come back to you next, because Mark Cousins also includes a moment from your film Winter's Bone when he's talking about adult child relationships, mm-hmm. and your films are so full of these really rich and complex relationships across generational lines sometimes, and many other types of relationships. Could you talk a bit about how you approach the crafting of character and maybe character relations? That seems like such an important aspect of your filmmaking.
Well, I think I'm always starting from a little bit of a documentary place, and I'm trying to go somewhere close to the source. If it was an adaptation from a novel, try to go to the county where a lot of the life that's described in the novel unfolded, you know, whether it be in southern Missouri or in Oregon and in Portland area, and see who is living some part of a life that, you know, was described, and then trying to learn as much about them. How are they relating to different people in their lives? What does that look like? You know, when are certain relational bonds blurred, meaning, you know, if someone's being primarily raised by their aunt instead of some, you know, learning that, what does that look like? Who, trying to find out what a character did learn from those in their family that came before them, from a neighbor, a close friend. You know, I'm always in kind of notebook mode, you know, listening very carefully and then trying to observe. So if someone says, in Southern Missouri, and they're 6 years old, and they tell me that they know how to obtain dinner. You know, they could obtain wild game. You know, oh, who taught you that? Can I hear more about that? You know, and so I try to get those notes, because those are not things I know.
Right.
They're not part of my experience. And so my note-taking is my route to trying to include as many of the unexpected things about the people we meet in our lives. You know, you can't jam them all in, but maybe then a little bit taking from that concept of the bittersweet. And the word "and" always yields the bittersweet, right? And so someone is this and they're this, and those are gems. Because that's where we say we defy expectations. Right? Someone defies our expectations because they do this and they do this. They hold this belief and they hold this belief.
Mm-hmm.
No.
Yeah, contradiction and complexity. Yeah, that you're embracing these things.
And
yeah.
So maybe it's the note taking. It's the anthropology. You know, but it goes down to visual anthropology, right? Because notes, what are they in the visual world? They are the visual. You know, visual notes are a form of anthropology. They're trying to understand how a person does what they do, why they do what they do by these visual notes.
Yes, yes, yes. So actually, Amy and Lulu, we have some craft questions from the audience for you guys. So I'd love to share those. Someone asks, Amy, your use of nature is astonishing and sun don't shine. Was that something you intended when you began working on it?
Yeah, I mean, I grew up in Florida, and there is what I felt like I wanted to get across is what it feels like to get there in a two-dimensional medium, right? Like there's no smell-o-vision. You can't smell their sweat. I can't like change the temperature in the theater. So how do you get that visually across with a two-dimensional medium And truthfully, we shot in the summertime, and that was really important to me. We shot like in the middle of July in Florida, and I made sure that we were only shooting in the morning and then in the afternoon, so my actors didn't have heat stroke, quite honestly. Also, I didn't have a lot of money, and I was shooting on film, so I didn't have that much film, so I had to really make it work. But I felt like every single location, even though I've never killed somebody, I laughed, that made it seem like I did. But even though I've never killed somebody, every single location I shot, and this is for filmmakers to remember when you're making something for like, I made that for like $40,000. Every single location was a location that I had a distinct memory about or attachment about growing up, every single location. And so I had an emotional attachment to it, but obviously playing out this very extreme situation. So like when people say, write what for me, it was, you know, when we talk about writing, it's like write what you know, but write what you know emotionally and try to stay true. But also for me, it was like these locations are loaded in so many ways and setting these sort of horrific scenes through that movie in locations that didn't have the best memories for me as a kid and as a teenager. Setting them there really gave the movie for me sort of an explosive thing as a director, and then bringing actors and everyone else that didn't have the same emotional attachment to it was a very interesting experience and allowed me to sort of direct it in a way. So I always try to find, you know, landscapes and everything like that, like as a character and as an emotional attachment to myself, as well as much as I am attached to the characters in a way.
Mm-hmm. That's a beautiful connection between, you know, the notion of people as character, but then also atmosphere, location as character. Lulu, so there's a question for you here. And maybe this writer has the farewell in mind. When writing and capturing a multilingual and bicultural story, How do you toe the line between showing and telling?
I'm not sure if that's like a question specifically for just the multilingual, or I think that's for any filmmaker, you know, because I come from a writing background. I come from music. I play piano since I was 4, so I'm like a classically trained pianist. And I wrote most of my life. I really come from, you know, prose writing. So I wasn't trained in visual storytelling. And that was a big part of making The Farewell and moving forward in my career, is I really had so much respect for visual storytelling and I wanted to get better at it. And knowing that that wasn't my entry point, you know, because again, I didn't grow up watching movies, and I wasn't given a Super 8 camera as a kid, you know, so I felt, I think I felt insecure about that, and it was a big learning curve for me. And so I just think always, if you can show it rather than tell it, always, you know, because that's the medium that we're working in. And I did The Farewell for a podcast. And so that was a really interesting assessment of saying, okay, well, how do you, like, it's the same story, but how do you make it work for different mediums? And really trying to understand how an audience receives the story through that medium, whether it's through their earpiece, you know, like just, and that's it, they hear your voice and that's it, you know, so that's a different art form versus through a screen. And so I, you know, tend to overwrite things, but I know that, and one of the reasons why I like to write and direct is because I know that the process of translating what I've written on the page to screen is really important. And sometimes my scripts might be long, but I just know, like, this 3-page scene, I just need to put it all in there, you know, like, I just need to, like, have people be extra talky just so that I'm nailing certain things down, especially in early drafts. But by the time I'm shooting, I can sometimes just go, all right, you know what, let's lose this entire scene and just have them stare at each other, or just do it through a hug, mm-hmm. you know, but for me, it's a process. Like, that's not necessarily my first go-to, because I'm always worried, like, I'm missing something and I'm going to lose something. So I do the vomit draft where I overwrite, and then it's easier for me to pare down. And I also, somebody, I can't remember where I heard this, but an analogy for writing a script is like sculpting. You know, you have to just really create the pile of clay, because that's your material. We're not given the materials. Are what we write, what we put on the page, are the materials. And so in the beginning, it can be really rough. You can tell a lot. You can be overly expositional and put all of it. But as you start to shape your sculpture, you have to carve away a lot. And I think if you are able to tell it through showing, like if you're able to do the scene visually, it also means that you really know what this scene is about. You know, it means that you know what you're trying to say, because so often if you just tell it and you get to set and they're like, you know what, we don't have time, we're over scheduled, you have to cut a couple scenes, you're going to panic because you're like, but I like that scene, you know. But if it's like, it's actually just a goodbye. They don't need to say all those things. It's actually, you know, sometimes words can't express it, and maybe they just hold on to each other, you know, whatever that is, you're much more flexible when you're on set and you're faced with difficult conditions and you have to, you know, make adjustments to what you're shooting. Mm-hmm.
Can I just say that Lulu Sunset is the most epic thing right now?
I keep trying to turn the camera to like get it, because I'm like, I know it's.
It's creating a beautiful light. Beautiful.
There's actually a moment in She Dies Tomorrow that has a very similar kind of sun coming in and out there. Lulu, you anticipated actually another question that has come in, and any of you can jump in on this. It has to do with how each of you starts and manages the production process. So as you're moving your, you know, your vision into production, what are the opening moves that you make, and how do you manage that process?
I'll say it quickly, hiring somebody else to do it. Because I don't want to do it. I thought that I'm really bad at all that stuff, you know? And when I finally realized that and you know, found producing partners to take over that part, I was free to do what I like to do, which is think and read the script and work with the actors and whatever, but don't do what you're not good at, you know, or will slow you down from getting to doing what you're good at, you know, the storytelling, making the movies and thinking about, like, and freeing your mind up not to even think about that stuff. But I just can't produce all the time. You know, I can't do everything. I just can't. And I'd rather do other things than that.
Right. Guys, echo that sense.
Yeah, I mean, like show running and then going dipping out of like show running and then independent film. Like I like getting my hands in the budget, and I make sure that I hire people that keep me informed about that, because I think the financial is creative.
Yeah.
So there, you know, I know, but at the same time, I know my shortcomings. And I always say this to people, is like, you know, I as a director, I think your strongest thing is to understand your shortcomings and hire people that are way smarter than you in those departments.
Mm-hmm. And I agree with you. They're collaborators, right? I mean, and they're there from the jump, especially with film. They're there when you're, you know, if it's the beginning of your career, you're applying for grants, or they're there to help you, you know, with a credit card that you don't have, or, you know, get the equipment or whatnot. You know, they're there to help you, and they see something in you, and you know, they're there to do that as a collaborator. But think about it as a collaboration too. And that's what you're saying. It's like, it could be this creative and great thing, or it could be a bad thing too. So I don't want to talk about bad collaborators and producers.
You could be aware of that. Yeah.
Right.
I think that's the stuff that you don't really learn until you do it through experience, that they don't teach you, you know, the importance of the collaboration with a producer, you know, like the different channels of communication, the politics that you have to navigate, whether it's independent or studio and you're working with multiple financier, every situation has its own politics. And I really like systems, and I love efficiency. I'm a nerd about setting up systems, because I find like I'd rather put all the work into setting up a system that works, because then once it's running, it's efficient, as opposed to building something and realizing there's holes. And so every time I make a movie and it works really well, I fight to make sure those people are on my team no matter what the size of the project. And it's really important, because you might get to set and you don't have that person who's essentially your translator. Like I might have somebody who, like the people that know me well, they know that I love full transparency. I don't like to be have things hidden from me, but that's a really common thing where producers feel like, oh, let's not tell the director because we don't want to stress them out. We don't want to panic. And if you've seen my movie, The Farewell, I don't deal well with people not telling me things. And I grew up with people not telling me a lot of things all the time. So I'm constantly paranoid, you know? And so I can just feel it if somebody doesn't tell me things. So I almost just want people like from nothing to worry about. Here's what's going on. We don't have to deal with it yet, but just so you know, this is what we're doing. This is how we're managing. We'll keep you posted. You know, that makes me feel calm. Mm-hmm. And it took a long time for my collaborators to learn that. But once we communicated that, it made everything so much smoother, as opposed to making assumptions about the people that you're working with, because they're like, well, I was trying to protect you, and you're like, but that's not protecting me.
You know, this resonates with another question that's come in for this kind of last topic that we're going to be talking about tonight, having to do with kind of industry politics and the ways that you all are experiencing the present moment for women filmmakers, and how you're thinking about what's ahead for women filmmakers in the industry. Someone has asked, how do you protect your vision? Lulu, you were kind of getting at that, but for the other three of you, have you felt that in the process you've really had to be in a position of protecting your vision as you are actualizing your films, because of the nature of the collaborations, because of the politics of of filmmaking, film distribution. Deborah, what do you think about that?
I think to stick to some of the things that, you know, in terms of protecting something that means a lot to you, it might mean that you have to be more on the margins for some time, or, you know, I feel like certain things, this is changing rapidly, but, you know, for a long time, certain things were kind of ingredients, a checklist for something to be deemed commercial, to be deemed investable. And even in the indie financing world, right? Like, you know, I wasn't actually trying to hustle in a Hollywood arena, or, you know, in any kind of corporate filmmaking arena, or, and, you know, so this gets to maybe that question about what could change if, you know, a lot of us keep making the work, and if the history that the documentary shows becomes internalized, we would be able to change a couple things that have been, I find, very restrictive. One is sort of the definition, I think it was mentioned earlier, even like, what does epic look like? Or what is meaningful story? What does a meaningful change in a character's life look through different lenses? Mm. How do we define stakes? You know, in American storytelling, stakes have been very heavily tied to the threat of physical violence often, or, you know, so, I mean, that's just been a crutch or a very big through line that we just can't seem to give enough space for diversity on, you know. So stakes, attention span, what characters look like on screen, mm-hmm. teeth, body types, you know, we've been a very reductive storytelling society because we were working really alongside a system that prized hypersexualization and glamorization, and, you know, so I'm just saying, to wean ourselves from some of that, that if that's where your vision lies, like, oh, I'm interested in people that look quite different than any kind of iconography that the West Coast produced. You know, you do have to fight to protect that. You know, you have to, for a while there, you know, right there in that little period of my filmmaking life, I had to fight to say that I want to make films where young women are not required to take off their clothes in any form, unless the story really, unless they want to, you know, not because, yeah, unless they want to. And, you know, so, but that's hard. You know, there's a little checklist that says how much skin, you know, is there something there? You know, so those checklists, you know, is there a firearm? Are the stakes high enough? Is there suspense in this way that's been defined very rigidly? So those are things that I feel like we are very much actively as a very diverse set of filmmakers putting wedges into, which is exciting.
Yeah. Yeah. I want to share another question, and it's another question that relates to how you build your teams of collaborators. This one is actually from someone who is the head of cinematography at USC. And the questioner notes that while some women directors hire female cinematographers, the majority don't. And just asking, what can we do to provide more support for women cinematographers? I guess we could expand that question in terms of thinking about the representation, the opportunities for women crew members more broadly, and how each of you think about that and approach that in your practice. I saw you Lulu, yeah.
I have a really specific story to that, because I did hire a female cinematographer, and I really wanted to, but that wasn't a requirement. I said, you know, let's just make sure. For me, it was about interviewing a set of people that was diverse, you know, that I wasn't just interviewing one type of person. And, you know, but for most people, we get lists. I don't know if everyone knows that out there, but, you know, the agencies have lists of who they represent, and they're pushing them, and they're saying, well, this person did 10 Sundance films, and this person da 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 da, you know. And so you get these resumes, and you look at these reels. But I can't even count the number of reels I looked through, and I didn't resonate with the majority of them, even though they had all of these credits. And I felt there was a sense of frustration, like, we are sending you the best people in the industry, and they're not good enough for you. And like, what do you want? You know, that kind of attitude. And I was like, but I don't know. It's an emotional choice, and I just am not connecting. And so the way that I hired my cinematographer, Anna, was actually, I was 2 weeks about to go to China to start pre-production, and I still didn't have a DP, and everyone's like, just pick somebody. And my production designer was in New York, and she's like, oh, I'm having drinks with this cinematographer. We worked together years ago. We haven't seen each other. She just got back from China. She's Spanish. She's from Spain, but happened to shoot a movie in China. Oh, here's her website. And I looked it up. I was like, that's it. That's what I've been looking for. But she was not on anybody's list, you know? And if I had given into the pressure from just the production itself to just make a decision, or from agencies to say, these are the best people working in the industry, then I would have just picked somebody instead of trusting my gut. And The Farewell is my second film, and so I had another feature, and so I think that taught me a lot, that with my next film I had to trust myself more, rather than being so insecure and just feeling like I didn't know anything and going with what other people were saying. And I don't think I could have done that if it was my first film. So I think that's just to say, it's like the external forces will tell you, these are the best people, these are the lists. But you know, I specifically asked for women cinematographers, and on a list of 15 people, I would maybe have two women on there. And I would say that's just not good enough. And so until these lists change, we have to do a lot more work to look for talent outside of these lists from these major agencies.
Right. Right. Yeah. Does anyone have anything to add on this?
I'm still a little opposite that. I actually believe I want my cinematographer to be a woman and look just like, you know, look as close to the storytelling that I'm doing, you know? So I really actively, you know, anytime I'm, you know, putting together a pitch deck or, you know, in a position where I can have some say in who the DP is and the cinematographer, I will, and I have my collaborators who are cinematographers who I talk to about ideas. I'll try to get them on shows. You know, I'll try to get them in my pocket, like with The Watermelon Woman, Michelle Crenshaw, with Stranger Inside, Nancy Schreiber. With Stranger Inside, I said to myself, I want all my keys to be women, queer, or people of color, and that's what I did. And that was 1999, you know, and it's amazing that, you know, it worked out to having some really, like, and Effie Brown. I said, and if you're with me, you're going to move on up with me too. Mm-hmm. So you get, you know, and I felt that about that project and the process it was made and subject matter, et cetera. So I really will actively do that. And even in hiring extras, I try to make sure the extras in say an episode or something I'm doing is diverse, you know, and not, with abilities, like all across the, you know, I don't want you to put somebody in a wheelchair. I want you to go find somebody who already has, you know, has those abilities. And I want to see them in the forefront, you know, and I don't want to cut them out of the scene, put them next to the actor. You know, I want to really do it. Yeah. I'm not here to play, you know, because look, cinema is the seventh art. It's hella powerful, right? We learn all of our lessons from cultural production and being in our culture, television and film. We learn how to kiss, love, hate, you know, whatever. We learn it from this media thing. At least my media can have those things in it, even down to the littlest episode of something to, you know, a big feature where I'm, you know, doing something different. So I really actively try to make some sort of change. And the littlest thing that I do, if I'm walking on a show and I can't do anything, it's down to, you know, having day players, having extras that are trying to, and if that's all I can do, then I'll just do that, you know? And I feel like I've done something, but it really has to look, smell, and feel like me. And that's a variety of things, you know, but, you know, never mind.
And you're exercising your leadership there in a way that opens doors for people, sometimes can, you know, create careers for people who otherwise would not have been on the kind of list that Lulu was talking about.
Definitely, completely.
So we've got a couple minutes left. This has gone so quickly. but I would love to go across the panel with this really wonderful question that someone has posed. What gives you hope for the next decade of women in film? Any of you have something you'd like to share about what's giving you hope for what's to come?
Sorry, when you're not angry. 4 years. But also a rough, yeah. I honestly what I'm enjoying is how many voices are coming forward and how much diversity is being brought into media. You know, as Cheryl was saying, like as like that like we, you know, bringing people on screen, and even as simple as like what she was saying, what I was going to say to her, what I was nodding profusely, is what people forget is like when you're a director, people bring you, you have an AD when you're in the union, you have an AD that brings you extras lists. And a lot of times the extras lists are white men that like, and you have to say, I need more faces in the background. And that's just in the background, just right, to fill out the world. You know what I mean? Like, and so, and even in casting like principal characters, there's just like so many white people. So what's bringing me like just excitement for the future is like, there's so, I've seen at least on my end, sort of the representation, like everyone, it's on everyone's mind. You know, I can't say that like the world's going to be solved right now, but I do think that will help shape what we see in the future and the stories that are told, you know, is representation in cinema. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Wonderful. Lulu, what about you?
I think that, you know, one thing I've noticed with young women who are, you know, the next generation is that they have a lot more pride in the areas where I felt like I had shame, you know, both in terms of their culture and where they come from. I just feel like, not to say that there aren't bullies and all that still, but there's a lot more pride in their differences. You know, there's a lot more celebration and maybe that's not all parts of the world, but I do feel because media is slowly changing, there is little by little, still not enough, but little by little more representation, that there is more celebration and kids are like, they're not as homogenized. Like so many people I know, they have, you know, mixed race parents and parents who have come from different religions and, you know, who come from different countries and they might speak different languages. Yeah, and so, you know, you go to a school, all these kids are just, they all look different. And there is, I can feel that there's more of an embrace of that. And I'm really proud of them because I struggled with that for years and years. And I think that held me back from my creativity is just insecurity rather than the celebration of what makes you different.
Right, and how amazing it would be to have that generation bringing all of that into the next generations of art making and filmmaking. Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Deborah, what's giving you hope for the future?
You know, it's funny, you know, the not to just keep, you know, worshiping this series, but...
you can do that if you want.
But the reason why it gives me hope is because there were so many women that were doing very radical kind of experimental work and, you know, work that we just didn't, it shows that, first of all, that, you know, women always took risks. You know, it wasn't that it was like polite, circumscribed filmmaking back in the day, you know. You know, for every Jackson Pollock, there was a Lee Krasner, you know, there was always this, there was always this experimenting. And I think that excites me, that it's really, you know, we use this word a lot, but it really can disrupt just the seamless narrative that like the mold that we went into for, again, American filmmaking, the master mold, if you will, you know. And so I'm excited about the disruption part of seeing more experimental elements in film, and the sheer numbers mean, they do mean that the kinds of stories that get told are branching out a lot. So it's gatekeeping, you know, relinquishing the tight locks on those gates changes every time. It changed it with feminism. It changed it with, you know, on the night of RBG, you know, it's of thinking of her, you know, even what we know about great women in history, if that documentary hadn't been made on her, if the narrative film work hadn't been done, we wouldn't know so as a general population. She was allowed to take her place in history because we just knew a whole lot more about her. And, you know, how she did her studying with her kids in law school and, you know, and what her first paper sounded like and what it was like for her to stand up and read those words back in the day. So we have this archival, we have this recreation of it, we have all these different ways to understand women that have mattered a lot in history. So that's kind of exciting to think about. Like, we don't have to have that paucity anymore.
That's right. Yeah.
The more films made about women game changers, the more history is recorded accurately and the more we're fired up to continue to say time's up on a whole lot of things.
Yes, absolutely. I wanted to get Cheryl's thoughts about this quickly. I know, Gwen, we need to wrap up. But what's giving you hope, Cheryl, for the next decade for women in the industry?
I hope that that there are more women who are agents, financiers, lawyers. Of course, we need producers and directors, but I hope there's more people in that other infrastructure, especially brown and queer women. You know, for me, and that they're running the money. They're able to get money. They have that capital. They have access to capital. They, you know, they're in those positions. I think everyone wants to like be the storyteller that way, but I really do think that we need more people who want to. You know, like I'm just good with books. I just know how to fundraise. Boo, come over here. You know what I'm saying? Like, I want people who have other skill sets than, you know, I want to be a filmmaker. You could be, you know, I think that's one thing. And then the second thing is, I think I want everybody to know that, because this is the hardest thing for young filmmakers to understand. Like, why are you making film? Why are you wanting to be in Hollywood? What is Hollywood, right? I mean, if you want to have a, you know, be near Tom Cruise, you know, then go be a caterer, right? You know what I'm saying? But if you really want to be a storyteller, you know, maybe this is the path, right? But realize that there are lots of Hollywoods out there. Don't worry about somebody else's Hollywood if you're already beginning, like a young maker. Make your own Hollywood. That I had to learn that in the hard way. I mean, obviously I made The Watermelon Woman, but, you know, kind of keeping right size and my blinders on and not seeing where, you know, somebody else is getting this and somebody else is getting that, and reading those trades all day when, you know, they are saying the numbers are changing, but they're not really, because every day when I wake up and read Variety or whatever headline, it's like, blah, 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 has another deal. First look that. This is not diverse. Nothing really. You know, they're pushing some of these stories forward on purpose. But at the end of the day, things. So I just try to keep in my Hollywood, make my Hollywood, keep my lane like that. And it's good, right? Yeah. And it was enough Hollywood for everyone. Just think about it that way. And I think you'll have much more success than worrying about what you don't have. But because you do have a lot. And you have a vision, you have a hope, you have friends, you have collaborators, you know? So take in that and take in that richness and leave the rest behind.
There we go.
On those words, I'd like to thank you, Cheryl, Deborah, Amy, Lulu, and Jacqueline for really an enlightening conversation. Thank you so much for joining us today. We are hoping to see you again and share those stories again. And to the audience, I'd like to thank you for zooming in.